It's on. He just gets closer and farther with each of them. Okay. No.
You're really going to do that, huh?
Yeah, what do you have in line here for?
Well, look at that. That's how I make the news. Okay, thanks.
Where is this gym? I can't get any closer to him.
I don't blame him at all.
Yeah.
Hey, you got your camera.
Can you hear that?
When you said this, it was like
no, do it again. Thanks.
That is a great day.
Oh, that's
how's it going?
Okay.
What do you want to drink?
Nothing right now, thank you.
What on earth is he doing?
How wet did you get?
Huh?
How wet did you get?
They didn't put me on.
They didn't? Good.
No.
I mean, I guess that's...
They had a couple young bucks there and decided to go with them.
Yeah.
It's going to be a long week, though. What the heck? Somebody's going to get me.
Yeah.
Shake him cool water out of his ear.
Yeah,
it's in there.
Do you
want to run it along?
Yes,
it's in there.
Oh, it is.
That
looks like
it's not very good. I don't know. We did a pretty good job. Right here? No. I don't recognize it.
Yeah, he cooked the corn.
Oh, okay.
Corn. Remember,
he was... Get down! Quick, bring his music ball. Well,
Sean is going to call and tell us.
You get me working, huh?
Yep. Yep.
Hey, you got a little trouble getting that above your belly.
You gotta be nice to him today.
Oh, okay.
Oh,
why? I'm glad you didn't save the rest of us some food, baby.
What?
I got your 7 up.
Good, thanks.
You
save
the rest of us some food. All right.
Bring some milk on now. Got all these things stuck in his earbook.
I broke my leg.
The only thing I remember about the center is that he was getting drunk.
I brought her down.
Yeah. Let me see.
Hey, Mike.
Really?
I'm
glad Sheldon was gone. I followed him in. I baked it.
I didn't run my cutter too fast, now, did I?
Somebody mentioned that to me last night.
He did, but I was on Tyson. Yes, they were smashing. didn't work. He didn't have to.
Yeah, but he was just really. Before he graduated, he went to another school.
Right. Right. And we did invite him to 25th. And his wife said,
Yeah, he's got to get some heat on him. Hey, those papers are starting to rip, Stanley. You shouldn't have them out in the... You shouldn't have them out in the wind like that.
In fact, you might even need to
see them.
WCNR.
Thank you.
Your dear wife figured that one out. We didn't like him because we knew the breeze would blow.
She's counting them now.
We don't know how many's there. It was only what's in the box.
20.
Wishful thinking.
Yeah.
So you can do the honors of cutting it. There's probably a knife up there.
You know that thing right across from E. Ryan?
you know the place? Captain Ann Holmes, right across from the new Cooper Gully.
It's on. You just get closer.
Yeah. Two more shots.
See the printed program. And he said, well, there isn't a printed program. It's whatever you want to do. And that kind of reminded me of another story, the story of Jeremiah Jones. He had a very serious stammering problem. Couldn't hold a job because of this. One day he saw in the paper an advertisement, and he followed up on this. It turned out it was a book company that was advertising for people to sell books door to door. And like I said, he had a very serious stammering problem, but he followed up, he called them, and went in for an interview, and he was hired. And they could not understand how successful he had become selling Bibles door-to-door, if you would believe it. Cold canvas Bible salesman. So his supervisor one day said, you know what? Everybody we hire can learn something from this guy. I'm going to tail him tomorrow and see what his success is based on. So he followed him. About a car's length behind, Jeremiah Jones pulls up the curb in front of his house, gets out of the car. His supervisor gets out of his car and kind of hides in the bushes. And Jeremiah Jones goes to the door, rings the bell, and the conversation goes something like this. He said, good morning, man. He said, my name is Jeremiah Jones. And he said, I'm selling Bibles. He said, would you like to buy one? Or do you want me to read it to you? So I guess my question is, in terms of what I plan to do, do you want me to...
And Ron says, guess what? You're reading it. Anyway, here goes. It's a poem that I found, author unknown. And so it's kind of, I guess, really shows us what tonight's all about. It's my class reunion, all through the house. And dim down the light, roll back the years, and we're young for the night.
All right.
That kind of says it all, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Let me introduce a couple people before we have dinner. We don't have a lot of people from the faculty here, but we do have one special person here from the faculty, and that's Mr. Golder. Mr. Golder, we're glad you're here. I would say personally to you that in my life there were two men that had a substantial influence on me. One was my father, and this is the other one. I spent 33 years in education, and this was always my yardstick, Coach Golder. Thank you. I understand he has a birthday coming up sometime this week, and though it's premature, I think we'll sing happy birthday, if you don't mind, Coach.
I'm supposed to be here, and if I have to use crutches or a wheelchair or a sitting, I don't. Some health problems, she couldn't be here, but she extends her thanks and my thanks again for being here. Thank you.
Is there anyone that hasn't had their picture taken four times? we're doing pretty good here. Anyway, congratulations to all of you for attending here the 50th reunion of the sesquicentennial, bicentennial Bloomsburg class of 52. I think we started out, I think we graduated 128 strong, and I think we have over, about 63 here tonight, so that's a wonderful thing. 55% of our class around there. I think that's magnificent. Anyway, I think we should recognize some of the efforts that went into the this 50th reunion, and there are a lot of people involved and responsible for this. And I'd like to recognize these people now. We had Nancy Klein, Nina Felster, Marianne and Roy Shaker, Gary Lawlaw, Ron Neitz, Jim Turner, Pat Cabellas, Joanne Beyer, Nancy Schumann, Jack Hagemeyer, and Jim and Joanne Calhoun. And I know that I noticed in Ron's memorabilia book there that he referenced Carrie Murphy, who was a good friend of his and helped him put it together. I think special recognition ought to go to certainly Ron Neitz, who was the email king for a long time here. That thing together, and he did an excellent job, and I think it's a lot of fun to read through that and compare the pictures and so forth. And also Jack Hagemeyer made a significant contribution in his address list book there that he gave you last night, so let's hear it. Is there anybody that I didn't recognize here that I gave you these phony names like married names and things like that. I probably don't recognize them. But anyway, if we was at the group, I think. But there were a lot of I think also we certainly appreciated last night if we attended the picnic out there at the Eri Fester's place. That was a great thing to have to get together there. We've done it for a number of years, and to have the shelter of the barn in the storm, I think that was a very good thing. Anyway, also just to recognize the other class officers, Nancy Snyder was vice president, and she's sitting back there at the table. Raise your hand there. And she's always very steady and calm and cool, so we appreciated that. We had Joyce Lundy, and I saw Joyce tonight. There's Joyce, and she's so meticulously kept all the historical records. And then we had whatever they were.
That hysterical.
And Nancy Dyer, there was our secretary treasurer. And now what she tells me is that the class money and treasury that she had, she invested it very wisely. And so each of you can pick up a set of car keys as you leave. Is that true, Nancy, or was that just something? Anyway, I think the Elks Club was a wonderful place here. I think we all had a good meal here tonight, and it was really good. I know they were trying to book Mustang Sally's or something. Couldn't get in there for some reason. I don't even know what that is. Before I leave town, I've got to find out.
I wonder where you went last night.
Well, yeah, that's right. I mean, you guys thought that I left. Anyway, I just looking at the memorabilia to kind of catch up with things and find out who was who or try to second guess, I noticed that we played a trick on you, and that was we didn't put the pictures in an alphabetical order. I don't know whether you noticed that or not, but it was pretty tricky there finding the pictures. And I also need clarification because I noticed a lot of reference to the girls from Centralia, Benton, and Springbrook. Is there anybody here that can clarify what that is? apparently I missed half of the high school life. So anyway, I think over the course of time, 50 years seemed to have kind of melted away. I mean, it's hard to believe that it's been 50 years. A lot of things have happened. We've had moonwalks and the Berlin Wall's been down, and of course we now have cell phones, right? And I think even though they thought we were technologically challenged, we all managed to drive with a cell phone in our hand now, right? So I think that's pretty much a good achievement. I think that what I would like to say at this point is that we have a great group of people here. We enjoyed our time at the up through graduation and beyond. We have a lot of classmates and friends. And the interesting thing is we all tried to conform when we were in high school, right? And then we recognized you could be very unique people. But when you get the group back together again tonight, everybody's pretty much the same good people that we had when we were in high school. I think you all deserve a hand of applause. Again, I appreciate you all being here tonight, and certainly it's been a great event, and Ron's done a wonderful job here. I had that monkey joke, but he wouldn't let me go. Anyway, thank you very much.
Okay, I'm going to ask Neil Davis to come up. We'd like to honor and recognize the people who have passed away from our class, and we'd ask you to bow your heads as Dale is mentioning those names, and we'll try to remember them in our hearts and in our minds and certainly in our prayers.
I think the older we get, the more precious life becomes to us. So let's each in our own way remember those classmates of ours who have passed on before. I'm sure our lives are richer and fuller because they were part of our school years. Listen to the reading of their names as you bow your heads. Edwin Blaine Adams. Lawrence Carl Bissett. Ellen Marie Bowman Albeck, John DeLay, Doris DeWald Moyer, Paul Fawes. Sheldon Fawzy. Eri Fester. William Grace. Elsie Harris Hess. Jean K. Hess. Robert M. Kaiser. Teresa Kassab Riordan. Ronald Llewellyn. Patricia O'Brien Price. Gail Pitchford. Vivian Skelding Mellick. Donald Tyson. Norman Yodi. Thank you.
Thank you, Dale. Carl kind of stole my thunder because I too wanted to recognize the committee. They're really the glue that holds us together. I know a lot of us live away from this area. It makes it tough for us to become involved in the planning. But I guess, honestly, we're going to have to become more active because I think the committee's wearing out. We'll make an appeal to you later in the evening, and if you could spare time between now and the next scheduled reunion, they can use some additional help. I also received a note. I thought I had the names of all the MCs, or as I call them, the guys driving the buses, the monkeys, but I missed Jack Hegemeyer. I was given his name. He was the MC at Bry Heights, so I apologize for not including you. I think Pat wants to make a comment now concerning the committee.
The only thing I wanted to comment about is I don't think Romney's has gotten enough adulation. He put his heart and soul, and I don't know how much money into this thing. And I think, Ronnie, stand up, please.
To add that also, the work Jack put into this booklet, the directory, we owe a debt of thanks to you, Jack. Thank you. You know, it's clear, I think, as you read the memorabilia, that members of the class have had a variety of successes of one kind or another. At the same time I say that, I guess I have to say that success is really relative. Some people say it's a little bit like the bell curve. At the age of 4, success is not peeing in your pants. At the age of 12, success is having friends. At the age of 16, success is having a driver's license. At the age of 20, success is having sex. At the age of 35, success is having money. At the age of 50, success is having money. At the age of 60, success is having sex. At the age of 70, success is having a driver's license. At the age of 75, success is having friends. At the age of 80, success is not peeing your pants. Somewhere. I came back to Bloomsburg as a teacher in 1957, and I guess one of the advantages that I had at that time
you have access to some things from classes that were in school prior. For example, art class, 1952. And it's amazing what they keep in the archives. I was able to put my hands on some of these things, and I thought we were a pretty smart class. I want to share some things with you, and you can kind of draw your own conclusions. I don't know how good we were on vocabulary, because I want to share with you some boners that were taken from test papers, and I suspect that some of them were ours. We're defining adolescence, and it was defined adolescence as the stage between puberty and adultery. Identifying bamboo. A bamboo is an Italian baby. A census taker is a man who goes from house to house, increasing the population. The Last Supper is a sacrament administered to a dying Catholic. An epistle is the wife of an apostle. A goblet is a male turkey. An oboe is an American tramp. The papal bull was really a cow that was kept at the Vatican to supply milk for the Pope's children. A refugee keeps order at a football game. A spinster is a bachelor's wife. An adult is a man that has stopped growing at both ends, but not in the middle. Anatomy is a study of heavenly bodies. Heredity means that if your grandfather didn't have any children, then your father probably wouldn't have any either. And neither would you. And finally, an illiterate child is one whose parents are not married. So that came from the archives of VHS. I suspect that's part of our contribution.
John, would you ask the class if anybody knows what our class colors are?
Pat wants to know if anybody knows what our class colors are.
Red and white.
It's red and white.
Green.
Somebody over there?
Red and white.
No.
Always was
green and white. Green.
Green is white.
Yeah. I knew it. I knew it. Get the yearbook out.
I've been asked to share with the class also that Elaine Waterman had made a contact with a classmate expressing regret that she couldn't be here, but vowed that she would be at the next reunion, so I guess we'll need to hold her to that. I have a little exercise I'd like you to do as a class. Where's Jim? Jim Calhoun. He's got copies. I've tried to make a diagram here of the high school. I'd like just the members of the class to participate in this because it's entitled Getting to Class on Time. So Jim will give one to each person. Raise your hand so he knows who the people in the class are.
I hope he knows who they are. Oh. Who's going to tell you?
You'll never get one.
All right. Hey, the number is 817-577. That's Dale. Is that Dale? Okay, Dale, you've got the picture. Congratulations. The second prize will be an Afghan which says Bloomsburg High School class of 1952, 50th reunion.
Ron, it should be noted that Suzanne Pennington Avery made that and sent that to the class.
Okay. It should be noted that Suzanne Pennington made this and contributed it to the class for this drawing. Winning number is 817-600.
Pauline!
All right.
Suzanne.
Pauline, you want to come up and claim your prize?
Pauline.
I
don't know what's in the bag, but it says Main Street something.
Interior.
Main Street Interiors, downtown Bloomsbury. 817-591. All right, Don. Got the same thing, I believe. All right. Discovering Bloomsburg, a bicentennial history. The number is 817-572. 817-572. Jack Tegemeyer. Bag from the company that I work for, Perkiom and Tours. And the number is 817-585. All right.
Winner every
time. Red and blue out.
I think most of us have had the experience probably within the last maybe 10 or 15 years of having to look out for parents perhaps that are not doing well physically. Maybe you're still doing that, or maybe your parents have passed on. I say that, and I also want to share kind of a humorous story with you that relates in kind of a way to that. Three sons left home, and they went out on their own and prospered. Got back together, and they discussed the gifts that they were able to give their elderly mother. The first one said, "I built a big house for our mother." The second said, "I sent her a Mercedes with a driver." The third smiled smugly and said, "I got you both beat. You remember how Mom enjoyed reading the Bible? And you know, she can't see very well. So I sent her a remarkable parrot that recites the entire Bible. It took the elders in the church 12 years to teach him. He's one of a kind. Mama just has to name the chapter and verse. The parrot recites it." Soon thereafter, Mother sent out her letters of thanks. Milton, she wrote, "The house you built is so huge, I live in only one room, but I have to clean the whole house." Gerald, she wrote to another, "I'm too old to travel. I must stay at home most of the time, so I rarely use the Mercedes, and the driver is so rude." "Dearest David," she wrote to her third son, "you have the good sense to know what your mother likes. The chicken was delicious." Announcements. One is an appeal to all of us to participate on the committee. As I said before, the committee is kind of getting tired.
getting worn out, and I think it behooves all of us to think about how we can help. They'd like a chairperson. It doesn't have to be somebody that lives in town. I do have to say, I think the people in town are the glue that keep us together. I oftentimes wonder what it is that causes us to go back. Ronnie tells me we came from, 13 different states to get here. And I guess we almost bleed a little bit of red blood, panther blood, I guess, to be here. But the committee does need some help. If you seriously think about it, be willing to serve on the committee. I think it might be tough for somebody living out of the area to chair the committee, but they do need some relief. So give us some thought. Nancy, do we have any business items that we need to take care of?
I was just wondering what if anyone would like to say at this point in time if they'd like to be chairman for the 55th.
Oh, yeah.
We'd love to know. If there's somebody out there that really wants to.
All right, Nancy's sending out an SOS saying if anybody would really like to serve as chairperson for the next event, they need your help.
You should have one before we leave.
Yeah, you want to lock the doors before try to get one? Okay, Ronnie Deese has also asked me to announce to you that he has photographs. If you want your photograph returned, he's got them with him. So if you loan them to him for the memorabilia book, he's got them.
And also the CDs, if anybody wants any, I'm out of them. I did 10 of them and they're all gone.
Okay, he has CDs. He did 10 of them. They're all gone. But if you want them, he can make more. Are there any comments or announcements from the group that need to be made? Nancy?
I'd like to say that on the centerpieces, the person that has the birthday nearest to this date may take the centerpiece home. At each table. Jack, is that you again? Whenever your birthday is near, it's August
7th.
And the thing, Jack, is your golden birthday.
That's
my golden.
It's Mr. Golden.
Okay, let me close our affairs for the evening, perhaps on a little bit more of a serious note. We did go to school to learn, and I trust that we have learned some things. But I'm reminded of Andy Rooney in his book, Things I've Learned. Let me just share a few things that we might be able to relate to. Andy Rooney writes, "Things I've learned, that the best classroom in the world is at the feet of an elderly person. I've learned that just one person saying to me, 'You've made my day,' makes my day. I've learned that being kind is more important than being right. I've learned that I can always pray for someone when I don't have the strength to help him in some other way. I've learned that sometimes all the person needs is a hand to hold and a heart to understand. I've learned that life is like a roll of toilet paper. The closer it gets to the end, the faster it goes. I've learned that no one is perfect until you fall in love with them. I've learned that I can't choose how I feel, but I can choose what I do about it. I've learned that everyone wants to live on top of the mountain, but all the happiness and growth occurs while you're climbing it. And finally, I've learned that when your newly born grandchild holds your little finger in his little fist, that you're hooked for life."
Ronnie, we'd like to thank you so much.
You bet.
When we leave this place tonight, we take only with us memories, and I'd like to share one final reading, which is entitled, "You're My Guest in Thought." Once a day and sometimes more, you knock upon my daydream door, and I say warmly, "Come right in. I'm glad you're here with me again." Then we sit down and have a chat, recalling this, discussing that, until some task that I must do forces me away from you.
reluctantly I say goodbye, smiling with a little sigh. For though my daydreams bring you near, I wish that you were really here. But what reality can change, my dreams and wishes can arrange. And through my wishing, you'll be brought to be each day a guest in thought. Thank you very much.
Your heart, but I can dream. Around, you know, with that. I'm Chris is getting hungry, and so is Rod Kelsner. Like he needs it.
Look at him.
Looks like Jeff warmed over. Anyway, I'm Ann Dale.
I can email.